Merry Christmas to each of you. My privilege to extend to you the welcome of this church, but much more importantly, the welcome of Jesus Christ. You are welcome in this place. It's my pleasure to greet you this evening and offer my own personal welcome to you. I hope I get a chance to speak to most of you before evening ends, but thank you very much for your presence. Special welcome to those of you who are not normally part of First Presbyterian. Let me assure you that you can be. It's a real simple process. But anyway, we are glad you are here tonight and invite you to participate fully in the worship service. We will be celebrating communion and invite everyone to participate with us tonight. It is December the 25th in Bethlehem, West Bank today. Right now, and so it is Christmas already in parts of the world. May we tonight pray that the arrival of Jesus Christ in this world will again have impact across all nations and languages and peoples, and that we can feel humbled and privileged to be a part of what God is doing in the world. This church is grateful to be a part of the Church Universal, to recognize that all those who call upon Jesus Christ will be heard, and they stand with us as our brothers and sisters. And we continue to pray for peace for our world and for greater understanding of what it is that Jesus has come to bring us all. Again, welcome tonight. Let us worship God together. Please join me in prayer. Oh God, without the arrival of Jesus Christ in this world, we would scarcely recognize ourselves. While we feel the often huge chasm between who we feel we are called to be and who we are, we recognize that our lives have the goodness that they do because Jesus Christ has entered this world. It's because of him that we know words like love and grace, compassion and truth. It's because of him that we know the dream of brothers and sisters living together in peace. It's because of him that we have hope that transcends all of the difficulties and tragedies of this world. And without him, we would not know genuine companionship with each other. So tonight we thank you for this small taste of heaven, those times when we will be together across all divisions and across all time and place, and we will be one flock and one shepherd, and we will finally have learned your ways, and we will trust you fully, and we will delight entirely in the gift of love and grace, and salute each other and greet each other as genuinely beloved children, one of another, standing before you. All glory and honor and praise be yours now and forever, above the earth and upon the earth and under the earth, but all living things cry out to you. Thanks be to God. Amen. In our church, it's a tradition to stand for the call to worship and for the hymn. So if you would, stand as you're able for the call to worship and the first hymn, Joy to the Lord. In the beginning, God created the heavens and earth, and God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The true light has come into the world. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill to all. Number 134, Joy to the Lord. Hear these words of prophecy from the mouth of Isaiah. Look, the virgin is with child and shall bear a son, and shall name him Emmanuel. There will be no gloom for those who were in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light, and those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority shall rest upon his shoulders, and he is called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Great will be his authority, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish it and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. So a shoot shall come up from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the love of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge for the poor and decide with equity for the oppressed of the earth. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the kid. The calf and the lion will feed together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze together. Their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not destroy or hurt on all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea.
Oh,
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for him in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace and goodwill to all." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, just as it had been told to them.
Number 121, A Little Town.
Thank you.
in the Gospel of Matthew. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God with us.
For the mercy of I don't know what your Christmas traditions are, what memories you hold the most sacred around this time of the year. And I don't know what the past year or all the years of your life have told you about who you are and what life is all about, or what picture in your mind it has created of heaven, or what sense that you have of God in your life. But the story that starts in Bethlehem is meant to be for you. You may feel like you're an odd fit in the Christmas story. You're not a shepherd. You're not one of the Magi. You're not Mary. You're not Joseph. You're not one of the angels from heaven. Where do you fit in this story? Where do I fit? The fascinating and amazing part of this story is that all this was done not for those people, but for us. For us. For you. For me. This story that we tell every year around this time is meant to be a story that shapes who we become and what we think of ourselves, with a new sense of what God is doing. All of these people who were in these stories, they had no idea of what was happening. All of them have to be reassured, don't be afraid. Mary can say, I don't know how this can possibly happen, and Joseph is clearly confused. So tonight, you're still confused about the true purpose and direction of your life, or you have things in your life that are confusing to you. Or if you're a person who's still trying to figure out where your life is going, then obviously the Christmas story is for you. If you're living in palace and filled with power and feel like you have other things under control, then there's a cautionary tale, a cautionary story in the Christmas narrative. Herod, who should have known, misses it entirely. Zechariah, who's a priest, misses it. But old people like Anna and Simeon, and nameless, faceless people who we would only know because they're in the story, it's to them that this story comes. We don't live in Bethlehem. We don't live in Israel. We're thousands of miles away. And yet this story, this message, this gift from heaven comes just as surely to us as it did to them. And we have been given more of a peek through the gift wrap paper. Through the words of the scriptures, we have been given insight that they did not have. And so tonight, whoever you are, wherever you come from, this story is God's gift of pure love to you. Over your confusion and your lack of direction, perhaps. Over your long sense that's made you feel old and long way from the Christmases that you really remember. It all draws near to us. Just as surely as the angels appeared above us and sang in their symphony, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to you. This bread and this cup are our Christmas feast offered to each of you, and offered to me as well, because it's the table of Jesus Christ, and he has come to transform the world and turn us into brothers and sisters, beyond all of our individual stories, into this one story. God saw you, claimed you as his child, and will never, ever let you go. Thanks be to God, the arrival of Jesus Christ in this world. Amen. There is a worship litany written in the worship bulletin. I invite you to join me. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
And God, we do give you thanks for all that you have done for humankind. We lift up our voices and thank you the choirs of angels and all those of every place who call out to you as Lord and Savior, the people who call out to you in the darkness and still seek the light to shine on them. We thank you that Jesus Christ has entered this world and has shown us as much of the truth as our eyes and hearts and faith have been able to absorb so far. But we strain forward towards the future when we will see clearly, no longer in a glass darkly, but face to face. And we will see the purpose that you have intended for us from the foundations of the world. That despite all that has gone upon this earth that has wounded your heart, you have breathed out even greater love each time. Your faithfulness is beyond comprehension, and your compassion exceeds all of our imagination. So this night we thank you. We thank you for all of your gifts to us, but especially this night for the arrival of Jesus Christ in this world. And in honor of all that he has done for us, and in honor of his birth, his life, his death, his resurrection, his ascension, and his soon return, we pray this prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the very night that he was betrayed by one of his own disciples, Jesus took a loaf of bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death and resurrection until he comes again."
Thank you.
Let us take a few moments in silence to pray for ourselves, our community, our country, but for the whole world. And then I will close this in a few minutes with a few other words. Let us pray. Oh God, let all these prayers come up to you as a fragrant offering of our sacrifice. So small in comparison to what you have done for humankind since before the foundations of the world were laid. But these are our prayers, our longings, our hopes, our need of you. We offer these prayers as we stand with all our human brothers and sisters around the world. And we lift up our hearts and the eyes of our hearts to you and ask that your goodness rain down on us. Not because we deserve it, but because we need it. And so tonight, O God, we are privileged to say that your love has reached to us. Within whatever limits of our humanity and our faith, we hear you. We hear the word of Jesus resonating in us. And it gives us hope for the world because you are with us. You have decided to make this earth your home, to claim us as your people, and to not rest until everything is as it should be. And the ways of Jesus Christ become the ways of all human beings everywhere. We pray for the grace to be servants in this world, to not be filled with ego, to be expecting other people to respect us just because of who we are, but instead to be gentle and patient, to be loving and forgiving, to do our best to copy and to live out the ways of Jesus in how we talk to the most distant stranger and how we think about our neighbors all around the world. We pray for this small earth, such an insignificant rock in the middle of a vast, vast universe. And yet you have put your favor here and allowed Jesus Christ to be born here. And so this night we offer up our praise, and I pray that you will bless each person here and fulfill the desires of their hearts, carry them forward in their lives until we all are with you in that great reunion of love, in that day when all will be clear, and Jesus Christ and the story of the Lamb will be our only story. Thanks be you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. This from the Gospel of John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or the will of the flesh, or the will of man, but born of God. And the Word became flesh, and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. The law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is only the Son, himself God, the one close to the Father's heart, who has made him known.
Remember the good news. Jesus Christ has come to this world.
Each one of you. May tomorrow bring fresh insight and gifts of love of how God has claimed your life and how the future belongs only to Jesus Christ. Whatever may come our way until we have this service again or we have it in heaven, may God's peace rest with you, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, And that ever-present companionship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.